Thank you so much, Vishwas, for joining me today.
Yeah, my pleasure.
As I told you earlier, I am developing a course on sales for youngsters who want to make a career in sales.
Fantastic.
So I came across your profile and I observed that it's very interesting and brings in a lot of diversity. So you were born and brought up in India, you worked for some time in India, and then you moved base to UAE and built a business from ground up in Africa. So that's amazing diversity. And I really want to understand how your experience has been, your key learnings, and then we'll get into specifics, how your experience could be useful for youngsters wanting to make a career in sales and especially in international sales.
Great. Yeah. Looking forward to this, this interaction and whatever, it's been a great journey for me in the last 15 years of my professional existence, I would say, and where I did almost like 4 to 5 years, I've been in India. I started off with manufacturing, trading, and purely I was always inclined to international marketing and always wanted to interact with, you know, foreign collaborators. And traveling was something which I was very, very keen, because that is one of the reasons why I took international trade as my key, my subject when I was pursuing my MBA, because I wanted to, it's fascinated me about, you know, the cross cultural diversity, I mean, interaction with, you know, maybe customers engaging in Africa or Europe or Asia, South America. So they all come with, you know, different, you need to have a different skill set, and in terms of their understanding of their culture. So I was always, that is something which really fascinated me, and just I took it, you know, step by step. And today, yeah, I've been in a good space as far as, you know, understanding the international business now better. It's no more like that. I don't believe that you can outsmart your customer. Yeah, you need to be smart, but there's a thin line between a smart and you being over smart. And that is something you need to be really be aware of. You shouldn't get carried away, because today the customers, they're well equipped with all the information. They're just at their fingertips. So, and you need to be very honest, something which I learned. You need to be very transparent with your customers. And that will really, that's one of the biggest learning that I think I could derive in my last 10 years of international sales. You be honest, you be really clean about your dealings. They respect you. And when they respect you, and I'm sure, you know, rest all is secondary. More than the sales, it's about how you know, that engagement with your customer, that man, I mean, how you interact with them is more important, understanding their needs and wants. And if that has been identified, and the rest all is, you know, it just comes along with it.
Right. Interesting. So you said you did your MBA and then, you know, you specialized in international business and you took up a career in international sales and marketing. So now let's say a youngster who does MBA today and steps out of college, and his company posts him in India and expects him to sell products, let's say, in an African market. And he's only expected to travel once in a while. He's not posted in, let's say, Africa. So how does he start? How does he go about building his business there?
Well, first and foremost, you know, Africa is a different, it's a very difficult terrain, I would say, in terms of, you know, information is data, which is, it's not available very, very well. I mean, in fact, if you compare it with, let's say, if I wanted to start something in Europe or in US or even in Asia or South America, there are trade data available in, so where you can actually understand the market size, the potential based on what product you're selling. But in Africa, it's a little difficult. So the three kind of, you know, customers that, you know, I mean, for a company like us, we are purely into trading and distribution. So we don't follow a business model where we buy stock and sell. It's more on a back-to-back order with our customers who are purely importers. For example, there is one set of customers, like big customers like Olam. I'm sure you would have heard this name. So they believe in localization. So where they, you know, they see, okay, I see this particular market delivers cocoa or a cashew. Let me, you know, put up an plant, a cashew processing plant, also an office there. And then they do their business there. So that is one way of, you know, one kind of setup that they do. The second type is, you know, you tie up with a local partner. You identify a local partner there and, you know, collaborate with them. And then you start business. The third is third kind of set of customers whom it's like us. We identify only the potential customers whom we think they are importers, and we work on a back-to-back order. And so these are three major set of, you know, profiles that you find mostly in Africa. One very, very important and crucial thing for anybody to start when you look at a market is your market research. You need to research very well about, you know, the product that you're dealing in. If it is an IT, of course, I'm not in IT, but what I understand is even in IT-related services or platforms that, you know, let's say a telecom company or like a Vodafone or a Bharti Airtel who wants to, you know, collaborate with a local operator in Africa. So what all, how different he is from a Vodafone or maybe an SLR, any operator for that matter locally. So he needs to, it's more easy for them to actually build their case in a service sector, because there's not too many players there, because it's more of it's a service which comes with a lot of you're specialized. It's a very specialized business, right? A telecom operator, unlike us, where it is we need to there are too many players in the market, so you're trying to create a niche for yourself in that particular market. So for us, what we look at is, you know, whether do we have a potential in that particular market, and once we identify that, and you okay, who are those players, who are those customers that you wanted to engage, you segment into, you know, importers, wholesalers, retailers, and different categories, and you segment them, and then in those segments you try to, you know, you create a platform. Let's say I create a universe platform for a particular market. From that universe platform, I go to a market platform where I know key, I screen them. Okay, from these, I now am going to, you know, target this customers in my market platform. From the market platform, I bring it to my buying platform. In the sense that, okay, I've identified them based on my the terms and condition and what I can service them. So from the buying platform, from the working platform, how can I bring them to my buying platform where I know the deal has been stuck. Now he's become my existing customer. So market research is very, very important. So it's that is very crucial for us to engage with any new customer. Very, very important is your product knowledge is very key. I usually need to understand the trade barriers in the, for example, you have to look at into a macro and micro level. For let's say I wanted to supply steel. I want to do a steel business in a certain market. If there's an anti-dumping duty there, I mean, I'm just, you know, beating around the bush. I should know this fact, the very fact that, you know, there's an anti-dumping duty for steel, let's say from a China or an India. And there's no point that, you know, I can supply in that particular market. So I just leave it there. I should escape that market. I should exit that market quickly, ASAP.
Of course. But
I have done these mistakes. So these are the mistakes, you know, this can be, you know, it's something that, you know, one should be ready. Okay. Before you engage into a new market, So it's very important to know the trade barriers there, and what are the, and also the once the macro thing is okay. I mean, you know, you still have, then you go to the micro level where, you know, you engage with your all the platforms that I spoke, you know, you have a universe, you create a universe, a market platform, a working platform and a buying platform. So that's how you need to engage in. So this is how I tend to look at the market. So I see the potential there and then engage. So create out of 10, 5, 6 customers, engage them, bring them into that, you know, continuous engagement, and bring them to your working platform, and then they're on to your buying platform. So that's right.
You mentioned one important point regarding this anti-dumping thing, but I think that is more to do at a strategic level where the company management has to take a call and do this analysis first before maybe putting in sales guys on the field. Now from an entry-level perspective, from a sales guy's perspective, you said the African market is very, very difficult, much more difficult than we perceive it to be compared to the Western markets, right? But the Western markets, again, are more developed and already stable. So it might be having its own vendor relations, vendor bases. So how does a guy sitting in India try to crack into those markets compared to an African market?
See, it's a good question. The thing is, there's a myth that, you know, markets in Africa will garner you more result, you know, in terms of the result that you're looking at than matured markets. It's actually the opposite. In matured markets, you can still find a way out because there's always some gaps, you know. You need to find opportunity within those. It is not that, you know, you still can create a niche in those existing in matured markets, whether it's in Europe or let's say in Africa. So if you go towards the North Africa, which is more developed, mm-hmm. They consider themselves more developed, where industrialization has really, you know, taken place, and a lot of industries which has been booming in North Africa, and so there's a lot of opportunity there where we can pursue in looking at the gaps, because there are certain things which we think that we can cater the customer out of Asian. Let's say I can get some kind of a specialized steel from Taiwan or from Korea or from India for that matter, which cannot be catered from Europe. For example, because let's say I find a very interesting product like a slit, a product which is from UAE, which I can cater to a market like Algeria, which is in the North Africa, because they have a special duty arrangement, Arab treaty. They call this an Arab treaty because end of the day, they come under Arab Union. So there's a duty benefit that they have. So I'm trying to exploit that thing, bringing a product out of UAE to Algeria, which they might not even know. Okay, is there something that do? So these are something that you need to find out. And you can only find out if you are engagement with the customer, it is at a level where, you know, he opens up, and which is very, very important. And because I can't do a cold calling and, you know, get an appointment from a customer. It might give you my entry level, but from there I need to build on. I need to know exactly who is my decision maker, and the decision maker most probably has to be the owner, especially when it comes to Africa, because it is not even relying to your procurement manager. So it's very important that, you know, I have to know that guy. If I can get 15, 20 minutes, because my product knowledge and my business presentation is very key there. Only then it is going to set pace to my future engagement. So you have to look for opportunities in like this in matured markets.
Great. Fantastic. Good input. So now Vishwas is sitting in UAE. So he operates out of, let's say, Dubai, Sharjah, these locations, and taps into the African markets. Now, if Vishwas was operating from Coimbatore in India, so how different would the scenario be?
Even if it is Coimbatore, even if it is Nepal, let's say, it doesn't make a difference. As far as you know the needs of that market. Today, I know, let's say I'm sitting with a product which is coming out of Nepal or a Sri Lanka for that matter. I will definitely, I would have defined my territory. Okay, which markets I need to look at in Asia. I will not go straight away that, no, I'm going to start, I want to do something in South America or North America. That doesn't really fit in, right? You will see if you can, target my SAARC countries. Then let me go to the ASEAN countries. Let me go to the broader Western. Let me go to the Far East. Let me go a little bit to GCC. That is how you go step by step. So it's very important. So you need to start tasting success at all levels. Only then you know that you build on that, that momentum, and you can proceed.
No, my question was, just to rephrase it, my question was, how is the base location perceived? Where a guy sitting in a matured market, how does he perceive a sales rep calling or reaching out from, let's say, some distant part, vis-a-vis somebody sitting in UAE? That was the question, actually.
Yeah, it doesn't make any difference. Like, for example, today, nobody anticipated that, a country like SEAT is actually manufacturing. They have a unit in Sri Lanka, and that is being sold in across the globe. So nobody thought so. If today I say that, because I know that, even from a smaller market, which is unknown to a developed country like in US and Europe, who doesn't know, okay, what are you selling from Sri Lanka? I said, look, I can do tires, and I'm selling, because I will give them, if I say that I'm doing this, it needs to be backed up with a lot of, data. Okay, look, you can check, because they can also check, where it is going, okay, from which are the countries that, I've been exporting to. And these information are nowadays very, it's readily available in the internet or through shipping companies, through port export data from whichever countries that they are, it's readily accessible. So it helps them to know that, no matter whether you're operating from any smaller country, it doesn't make, as far as, you are able to cater to the requirement of the customer, exactly what they need. And end of the day, if the price, the delivery, and everything, it suits them, then you start business. Hello?
Yeah, please continue. Yeah, please continue. Sorry.
Yeah, so these are the major, so this is what, I feel that it doesn't matter from where you're operating. End of the day, it is a product which is required by the customer. You're able to cater to that, and the delivery, you're able to deliver it on time. And today, they also do their checks, right? Okay, if you have a company has got a website, they will see the website. They do the due diligence also about the company. Okay, then once there's no, okay, the website looks good, he has got the product, so then you're in their consideration set. You see, okay, now let me do the due diligence. Then it's okay, let me start with a trial order of maybe. End of the day, they know that buying from a Europe or a US and buying from an Asia, it's come to the price, right? When I'm giving you the same quality at a much cheaper price and with a good service, where my shipments are more quicker. Let's say maybe coming from a Europe, which has got a very where the winter season is more on the higher side. So so I am able to cater to them. Okay, my delivery is much better than from what they are getting from Europe, or maybe they have some duty benefit bringing it from Asia, and then they also the packaging. Ultimately, if the package is, if I'm able to give them the package that they want, then it makes more easier for them. And see, they also travel, my suppliers also, customers, they also travel to trade shows, and you also exhibit yourself in various trade shows and exhibitions. So where they know that, okay, this company has been there, and why not try it? And if that particular company is calling you out, is trying to, be one of your potential vendor, and that also, okay, this is a very serious company. They will take you very seriously.
So I think the key takeaway here is that compared to, let's say, 3 decades ago, it is much more easier today to build credibility in the eyes of the prospect.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Today, you cannot cheat your customer. See, you can be manipulative to some extent, believe me, but that is not going to take you on the longer run. It will not yield results. So I always believe that, you know, you have to be very, you need to be smart. You need to understand what his requirement is. And then be very honest and, you know, be very transparent. Look, this is because they know what they're getting ultimately. Okay, you might sell, okay, one or two deals if you're not delivering the exact specification or the requirement the customer needs. He might try you for a couple of times. There's no depth of, you know, suppliers, right? He might ultimately has got option of 10 different guys. Okay, you don't give it to me, I will pick it up from somebody. So you have to create. So that is where, you know, your man management skills come in. What is the rapport that you create with your supplier, I mean with your customer?
So what would you say, compared to 3 decades ago, is it easier to sell or is it more difficult to sell to an international market?
See, three decades ago it was much more easier, but you know, you had your travel constraints, right? People now don't use to travel. So once in a while you go there, you could make good margins, but today it is not the case. Today, everybody know who is who. I mean, somebody sitting in a dingy room in a Mali or a Timbuktu, he knows his supplier based out of Tokyo or even in Beijing. So he's well aware, he's well connected. He has got his associate sitting in Dubai who's arranging for his payment. He has got associates sitting in Beijing or in Guangzhou who's going to, you know, arrange for his shipment. So you can see, so he has the entire supply chain connected. So anywhere he has an issue, he has got somebody to rely on. That was not the case maybe 3 decades ago, where, you know, supplier was the king. Today is the reverse. So, and you need to really acknowledge that. Everybody has got a role. The competition is there, but you need to find your way out. And for that, you need to know the market very well. You need to understand your customers very well. You need to have a good span of the pool of customers with you. So, and you need to have a tier one, tier two, tier three customers, which is very important, because in every market you need to have your anchors. One is going to anchor you, give you the volume that you require, but they might not necessarily give you the margins. Then you have a tier two customer who will give you both. They give you a little bit of volume and a little bit of, you know, the margins are slightly better than your tier one customers. Then you have your tier three customers where, you know, they might buy, the volume is less, but the margins are really good. So you need to play it accordingly. It's a level playing field, you know, once you understand. So it's, you need to be very open-minded. You need to adapt yourself, you know, like you cannot be rigid in international sales. This is one thing that you need to be very flexible. You need to, you know, your adaptive thinking must be very fast, you know. Okay, if this doesn't happen, because every, let's say a year back or 3 years back, you put a forecast for my quarterly forecast. Today it is not, right? It's changing. Today, monthly target, you have to create every month. I said what I can bring to the table for September shift. Like I'm already preparing. What is the billing or invoicing that I'm going to do for September? Which are my targeted customers? What are the business that are going to bring in? That is how I have to go now. Earlier it was so easy. 6 months you make a plan, you know, eyes closed, it will come. But now it is not like that, because markets are changing. You see, the COVID has really created such a huge. It's so extraordinary, right? Business really went. It was like downfall. Like for us, we didn't do any, like our business is already bleeding 40-50% down. We are looking at a slight recovery starting from end of June from now. We are there. I mean, possibly maybe by early next year, March, April, we believe that, you know, early we reach some kind of a plateau.
So
in business sense.
So if Vishwas was to hire entry level sales guys today, what kind of skill sets would he look for?
Basically he should be, you know, see, for us, cross cultural communication skill is indispensable. I mean, that's very, very important for us. especially if somebody wants to make their career in international sales. Your network, networking abilities, you know, you need to be, you know, whether it's LinkedIn, Facebook, or, you know, even you must be having some agents in some particular country. So who can, you know, help you with the market scenario there, like how to build up, you know, who are the customers who are located in various regions or provinces. So your network ability is very, very key. Then you need to be a team player. You need to, you know, your collaboration is very, very key, because to work together in team, it helps you to counter, you know, different problems, and that will actually define your growth in that particular organization. And then one thing which I earlier told you is you need to adaptive thinking, you know, because in an ever-changing environment, decision-making is so key. So taking the right decision at the right time is very, very important. No, you cannot come with a very, you cannot be rigid. You need to show a lot of strong emotional intelligence, you know, be flexible, be empathy. You know, empathy is one of very strong skill, I believe, that, you know, is very necessary for an international sales guy. And to top it all, resilience, you know, because there'll be a lot of, you know, failures and setbacks, but you should not accept defeat. So it's very important, you know, these skills or traits, whatever you call, is very, very, very important for any guy who wants to make a mark in international sales.
Fantastic. I think EQ seems to be a common thing, the common expectation from employers across.
Yeah.
So great conversation, Vishwas. Let me not take more of your time, but let me quickly sum up of what we discussed today. So you spoke about having three options to expand overseas. One, have a liaison office there, or maybe a trading or a local partner there, or a trading company who can do the trade. So that these are the three options. You mentioned that building credibility in today's world is much easier, because you can have a website, you can show product demos online, and you can connect with anybody across the world.
Like, but I missed out something. One was really this client testimonials, you know, these are very, very important. Sometimes that also helps, whether it's supplier or whether it is on client side. If you got testimony, let's say I wanted to go to a market like in Algeria, if I got a client testimonial, so that helps me to, you know, it will enrich my product, about my company, and it will give them, you know, okay, this is it's a very sound and, you know, it's a strong company.
Correct. So that's the upside. I mean, we are in a connected world.
Correct.
So getting testimonials, building credibility on website is all now much easier. But as you rightly said, that also means the market is hyper competitive and it's the buyer's market now. So
it is.
The buyer's market. So that is how the landscape has changed in the last three decades or so. For a newbie who is planning to make a career in sales, I think people are not looking for MBAs anymore. They're looking for more of empathy, EQ.
Yeah. Like, for example, then why can't an engineer go in? You know, it's a technical, let's say, I mean, it's a product. I have the product knowledge. Engineer would be anyway, 9 out of 10, he could be going to the market and selling. Why he can't sell? Because of them, these are their soft skills, exactly, which is required in terms of, you know, that is why, you know, you need to be, you have to have an engagement with the customer. You need to have personal rapport with the customer, understand his requirement. Like, for example, today I remember my top customers' birth dates and anniversaries. It's always listed. So I do a check on, you know, I wish them every time. And like his hobbies and interests, like one of my customer, he's a fanatic in terms of, you know, when it comes to football, he's crazy. So I have to make sure that he follows this English Premier League. So I have to make sure that, you know, he's a big Liverpool fan. So I need to be updated about Liverpool standing, you know, what match went wrong in Liverpool's, why they lost. So these things are very important for me to engage with my customer.
Right. So that is finding the common ground.
It's very important. Exactly. Common ground is very important.
So I think we are moving to more of a output driven culture rather than qualifications. So what qualifications you bring in don't matter, as long as you can network well and have empathy and build connections easily and get your job done.
Yes. End of the day, you have to get the job done, it should be a clean job where, you know, we make, it's a win-win situation for both for me as well as for my buyer, and also for the supplier from whom I buy my goods. So if all three are happy, that means that we have found a common ground, and and we pace our business accordingly.
Great. Thank you so much, Vishwas, for your time. I'm sure our learners are going to find it very useful.
Hopefully, yeah. Anytime. Take care. Thanks. Yeah.